Hello, today we are going to look at two important strategies which are one, narration and storytelling, because they are both connected. How they are going to be used in social sciences to make it more meaningful and more interesting. So these are two teaching strategies which you may use in your teaching learning and make social sciences very lively and interesting. Now, storytelling may be broadly defined as an ancient method of conveying ideas, intimations, and emotions in a narrative form with or without the accompaniment of music or visual art. Originally an oral tradition, storytelling has evolved from its earliest form to include a variety of multimedia applications. Folklorists generally do not approve of such inclusive definitions, although. And as a child, I'm sure each one of us has listened to different stories. You may forget chapters, you may forget poetry recitations, but you may forget, say, something which you have learned as a question or as a definition, as a law, so on and so forth. But stories you generally remember. Why? Because in stories, there is a sequence of events, right? And through the sequence of events and through the emotions, you are able to capture and you are able to remember it more, right? Now, in a scholarly analysis by Anne Pelosky, The World of Storytelling, she defines storytelling as the art or craft of narration of stories in verse or prose as performed or led by one person before a live audience. The stories narrated may be spoken, chanted, or sung with or without musical, pictorial, or other accompaniment, and may be learned from oral, printed, or mechanically recorded sources. One of its purposes may be that of entertainment. You see many stories, you know, which have also been made into films, right? And you also hear, for example, there's a with reference to social sciences, we have epics like the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, right? Which are also, you know, in verse forms narrated generation after generations, right? And it is a skill wherein the narrator communicates to the listeners through oral and non-verbal gestures, right? This withholds the attention of the listeners. In fact, it is an art in itself which aims at presenting to the students through the medium of speech, which is clear, vivid, interesting, with ordered sequence of events in such a way that the students are able to reconstruct these happenings and they live in their imagination through experiences recounted. Now, when I'm saying that through the narrator communicates to the listeners through oral and non-verbal gestures, while I'm communicating to you as well, you see, I'm not only speaking, but there are also expressions and my body language, which you can see. So non-verbal and verbal both have a lot of impact when a storytelling exercise is being undertaken. So it is very, very important that the narrator who communicates uses the kind of nuances, uses the kind of expressions and language such that the attention of the listener is withheld. Such that the listener is, you know, listening to you in rapt attention. It depends upon the expertise of the narrator that the story would be retained or the story would be heard. It is very, very important that the narrator has the expertise to narrate it with the kind of expressions such that the listeners feel interested in it. Going further, a teacher's capacity as an actor and speaker can make the lesson very lively. For example, if you're talking about a personality, okay, in history, and suppose you can also bring in the expressions or through mimicry, that story would definitely become very alive. So they can make also, you can make students visualize the events and the personalities concerned. To keep the listener on track, the narrator asks simple questions in between, which require to be answered in one or two words. This method is suitable to teach social science, especially history, at the elementary stage. This would arouse the interest of the children and provide them scope for imaginative understanding and thorough enjoyment. For example, in history, you may narrate how the different kings administered their kingdoms. Right? For example, you had the Gupta period. For example, you have the Maurya kingdom, so on and so forth. all the Chalukyas, you can always, you know, narrate them sequentially, right? And through these sequences, depending upon how interestingly you narrate them to them, they would not require to rote memorize. They would eventually be able to retain it as a story. So it is very, very important that you, for or in social science, in other subjects of social sciences also, for example, in economics, you may bring in the case study wherein of a successful bank, and that case study you may narrate it as a story of a successful bank which, you know, converted its absolute losses into assets, and this can be narrated as a story, and they may learn through that story. For another subject, for example, in social sciences, you may narrate, for example, or weave in important concepts like gender also into them. For example, you can narrate the story of a woman sarpanch who has been very successful in her village. And there are many success stories in India with respect to this. And the functioning of the panchayat may be taught through the narration of this story of this successful sarpanch. You can narrate it with reference to a successful woman sarpanch. You may narrate it with reference to a successful man. So on and so forth. So through success stories, you will be able to make them understand that how a panchayat also governs or looks at the functioning of the village education committee, how the panchayat samiti works, so on and so forth. So that it makes the entire experience very interesting. Otherwise, if you teach through a monologic method where you are telling them about the panchayat through a textbook, it makes it very dull, it makes it very monotonous, and therefore it doesn't arouse the interest of the learners. So let them imagine things. You can also use in storytelling, you can use pictorial representations such that their students take interest. And many a times you can also, whatever themes you want to take, you can ask them to weave their entire stories. Put the pictures and ask them to in sequential order and ask them to weave a story, which can be a very interesting exercise also. Now, how to use stories in teaching learning? First, share your own stories just for fun. Tell them about when you were their age, about times you failed, succeeded, or about memorable lessons you learned. This builds a strong connection between you and your classroom, letting them know that you can relate to them and vice versa. And this enables you to basically build a rapport with the students when you narrate your own stories. Then using stories as introductions. Just as we encourage students to use attention-getting devices for their essays, it is very, very important that we use the techniques of narration and storytelling as educators, right? Begin the class with an interesting story, but one that is relevant to the lecture's focus. For example, if you're talking about governance, the story has to be related to governance. If you're talking of taxes, the story has to be related to taxes. If you're talking of effective governance of a particular historical period, then the story has to come from that effective, or that historical period. So using them as introductions also works very successfully with reference to a given lesson. Then using stories as illustrations, when you're hammering through a relatively difficult concept with your class, one easy way to explain it is to illustrate the concept with a story. When facts and figures won't do, simple narratives sometimes can. When you narrate a story on a difficult concept, it is easier for students to grasp that concept, right? Because we have heard stories right from our childhood, say, till adolescence, right? So it's very, very important that you make that difficult concept easy. One, you reduce the level of difficulty by using a language which is simple, and bringing in conceptual clarity through examples used in the story. So the narrative becomes very simple through a story, and you're able to illustrate a difficult concept. Now, tie the story to the learning goals. We want our students to develop listening skills, and we can incorporate storytelling into the larger picture of achieving these outcomes. So when you narrate a very interesting story, your students are going to listen to you. But it's very, very important that you're able to hold their attention by narrating it in a very interesting way, And this requires also a little dramatization on the part of teacher. Your speech, your intonation, your expressions all work such that you're able to hold the attention of your learners. So you have to tie it up with the learning goals. Now, tell stories to engage reluctant learners. Many a times you see the students sitting on the back benches. They're they are not taking interest in the lesson, and we as teachers do not even give them the kind of attention such that they feel interest is. So it's very, very important that all the reluctant learners are, or you capture the attention of these reluctant learners also. Some students experience difficulty in connecting to drab textbooks. As you know, we have different learning styles or abstract concepts. They may not be able to understand the concept very easily through textbooks. So it is important that students who have a little struggle are able to understand these concepts by connecting to stories. Through telling stories, you make life and learning more relevant and giving it a better angle of engagement and making it more meaningful for your learners. So you're able to, you must be able to, you know, have them, and if it's a, suppose it's a very large class. So you can also tell the same story by dividing the learners into a number of groups and then by narrating the stories. You can also have one group narrate the story to another group, so on and so forth. There are different ways through which stories telling may be used. Now, there are types of stories. There are different types of stories which you may use. For example, there are stories which harbor knowledge of each different part of a life. For example, it may be a true story from your own life, or it may be a true story from the life of someone you know, like a friend or a family member or a neighbor, or a true story from a news or a current event. Okay, a story that took place sometime in history, a historical event, right? For example, you may narrate the entire event of partition through a story, the partition of India and Pakistan, so on and so forth. And different historical events may be woven into a story. A fictional story with made up characters or events. To explain a given concept, you may make up your own story. That means it is not a true story, but you have made it up as a story, and you are able to convey the concept through that story. Or the last situation, where it also leads to the development of critical thinking skills of your own learners, that you give them a hypothetical situation. Imagine if, and let them weave their entire story. The students develop the story, you know, and they feel very interested and energized when you ask them to develop a story, right? So this is the different types of stories which you can use. Now, why does storytelling work? In its simplest form, storytelling remains a very powerful element of communication, with the narrative being equally as compelling as essays and textbooks. They humanize learning, because that human element comes in when you are narrating a particular story. It is very, very important that you bring in that human element, you know, where a student is able to connect with what you're, because a story has emotions, a story has expressions, right? And if it's a real life story, even if a historical event, they are able, you should narrate it in a way such that they are able to relate to it. Okay? It offers us the opportunity to connect to like-minded characters or see the world literally from with someone else's skin. Stories touch our emotions and make us laugh, cry, make us fearful, get angry, a sharp contrast to a plain old presentation, right? Because in a presentation, you don't have expressions, right? In a textbook, you don't see expressions. So it makes the entire experience very dull and monotonous. So it's important that storytelling brings in this humanizing effect in learning. Plus, no matter how organized or detailed a textbook might be, there's something about the shape of a narrative, the exposition, the problem, the quest for a solution, the resolution that resonates with our mental makeup, right? That I am able to connect to the story if it's a real life story. I am able to understand the historical event if it is explained by giving me the examples, right? With expressions. And many a times through, the story may unfold in front of the learners through a role play, right? The entire role play, through the role play, you are able to tell the entire story. For example, the Queen of Jhansi. The entire story of the Queen of Jhansi may be taken up as a story which also has been, you know, taken up as a musical, right? That means the entire story is in the form of verses with music and the characters play the story. Students do not forget, they do not have to learn those facts, because it is such a powerful medium to make them learn. And learning which is interesting, which is meaningful, and which makes you connected with what is being taught. Now, what are the advantages of this method? One, as we just discussed, this method can create interest in the students and they start liking both the teacher and the subject. Many a times you like the subject because of the teacher, and many a times you like the teacher because of the subject. So it works both ways. So it's important that you create interest in the students, right? It can support development of imagination and inculcation of virtues, which is required for social living. Very, very important. Storytelling is able to achieve the aim of imagination, especially if you use stories such that when you ask them to weave their own stories. So they imagine, they think that what are the different characters in the story, how will this story go on further, right? And as a result, they are able to weave their own stories and think creatively and imaginatively. Now, when you're talking of inculcation of virtues, there are stories which have moral values. You all know there are moral stories as well. So these moral stories also have a deep impact depending upon how you narrate them. Students learn no more than what is given in the textbook. Now, there are certain limitations as well, right? Teachers play a major role in the narration of the story, and we know it. And if the story is not told in an interesting way, the students may feel bored, they may feel uninterested, and they will simply lose interest on the story being narrated. So, the entire purpose of narrating the story goes down the drain. It is also true that all topics cannot be taught through this method. So, the teacher has to be very, very careful which is the topic which I am going to, teach through narration and through storytelling. You have to, as a teacher, critically think and brainstorm as to which topic can be best taught using a narrative form of storytelling, or which topics are to be taught using the imaginative form of storytelling, that they weave their entire stories. Wherein can I bring in fictional stories? Wherein can I bring real life stories? So on and so forth. So there is a lot of homework which goes in on the part of the teacher, such that the teacher has to collect more information than what is in the textbook. And it has to be a highly skilled narration for the success of this method. You know, we generally think that storytelling is, oh, it is just a story, it has to be narrated. No. It is not just a story which has to be narrated. It has to be narrated such that the students feel interested. It has to be narrated such that the students are able to connect with their real life experiences. It has to be narrated such that they find meaning to it with reference to their real lives, right? And such that they do not have to rote memorize the facts of the story. So there's a very critical role of the teacher here, right? So it becomes, the storytelling will become a limiting factor or a disadvantage if it is not narrated in an interesting way with the emotions, with the kind of nuances of dramatization which it may need. You know, the tone and pitch of narration plays a very, very important role with respect to how the learners actually receive that story. There are some of us who are great storytellers. We have expressions, we have pitch and intonations which we use, such that the students feel interested, and we are able to, you know, bring in that element where the student is always curious, which is very, very important in a story, that there is an element of curiosity which you develop, right? That the student is constantly keen to hear what will come next. So if that element of curiosity is also woven inside the story, the students would feel interested as to what will unfold further, and they would be very keen to hear that story. But it is very, very important that we have clarity that where exactly will I use storytelling in social sciences as a powerful medium. Now, as we come to the end of narration and storytelling in social sciences, it is very, very important for each one of you to think about what are the different, you know, examples which you will take or use, or the themes or concept which you will use for storytelling. Where do you use storytelling in social sciences? For example, we just discussed in, for example, political science. If you are talking about political science, if you are talking of governance, you can have a story, a success story of different models of governance, okay, from our own country, from different countries. Okay, we can have comparisons, we can have data brought inside the stories. Or, for example, in history, about historical events, for example, we have the First World War, we have the Second World War, we have the Revolt of 1857, we have the Dandi March. All these historical events can be narrated very interestingly through stories such that the students do not have to mug the facts, right? Or do not have to rote memorize. Going further, for example, in civics, you can talk about governance. You can talk about successful governance models through stories, right? Or you can talk of citizenship. You can tell successful stories of citizens being, effective people to bring in the different grievances, to bring in, to take care of the community in which they live, so on and so forth. And you can also, as we earlier discussed, the role of different hierarchical levels in governance at the district level, at the central level, at the state level, at the village level. You can discuss these models of governance, right? And in economics, you can discuss the functioning of different companies. You can take the success stories. You can also take the stories which were not successful, okay? You can take the stories of startups, right? And these can be very motivating stories for children, and it can also encourage them for entrepreneurship in the long run. So that is also very important that you use the stories such that the students feel motivated with reference to learning social sciences through these events. And also, as we discussed, there is an aim of storytelling. You also have different kinds of values which you bring in through stories. Instead of talking about different values that, you should have this value, honesty is a best virtue, one should always be punctual, so on and so forth. Through the stories, you can weave in all these values and such that it will have more effect on the learners. So, narration and storytelling in social sciences are very powerful techniques, and you have to understand which story has to be used where. In the sense, there is a concept which is difficult wherein you do not have a real life story, so you may have a fictional story in place. Or you have a historical event. See, in a historical event, there is a chronology of events. And there is a event which is documented. So you cannot naturally have fiction to it, add fiction to it. So there you can narrate the entire sequence of events in a very interesting way, right? So storytelling, irrespective of whether it's history, whether it's civics, whether it's economics, right? In different areas of social science, it can be used as a very, very effective way to put your thoughts across, to teach concepts effectively, and make learning joyful and interesting for the learners, which is very, very important. If your learners are not interested in what you're teaching, the entire exercise becomes futile. So narrate a story such that the concepts are clear. Narrate the story such that there is no rote memorization. Narrate a story so powerfully that they feel interested in classroom teaching learning. And narrate the story such that eventually students start taking interest in the subject and the entire process of teaching learning. Social sciences is an area where storytelling and narration have a very important role, right? You may use role plays, as we discussed. Let the children play different characters in the story, right? They will learn about their characters by playing those characters. And it makes the entire teaching learning exercise so interesting, because there is hands-on experience, they are involved, and there is experiential learning. So I wish all of you all the very best for using storytelling in social sciences such that your class comes alive through this very lively strategy of teaching learning. Thank you so much.